praise be to Allah, our creator, the creator of the universe and of everything that's in it. And I seek his blessings and mercy to be with Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the seal of that long chain of messengers and prophets from Allah for the guidance of man. And I greet you, dear audience, in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, blessings and mercy be with you all. In the previous episode, we spoke about water in the glorious Quran. And I mentioned that water actually comes out in this noble book more than 63 times. Every time we read about water, we find a scientific notion that's absolutely precise and correct in the light of the givings of our time. And today we are going to talk about seas and oceans in the glorious Quran. And I would like to emphasize the fact that seas and oceans are mentioned in the glorious Quran more than 40 times. Every single notion about seas and oceans is actually a scientific miracle that contains a precedence with a scientific fact, not reached by man until probably the 20th century. And for the glorious Quran, a book revealed more than 14 centuries ago to an unlettered prophet, peace be upon him, in an unlettered society, to mention such an immense amount of scientific facts is a testimony that the Quran cannot be the work of man. It's the divine word and its divine purity. And it is a living testimony to the correct prophethood of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the last messenger for the guidance of man from the Creator, all glory be to him. I cannot cover the 40 notions about seas and oceans in an episode like this, but I will concentrate on one verse alone that came in Surah An-Nur, the light. The verse actually describes the acts and deeds of unbelievers. And the Quran tells us that unbelievers can do some good work in this world, and they can get their reward immediately in this life, and they will never get anything in the world to come. The Quran reads, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَعْمَالُهُمْ كَسَرَابٍ بِقِيعَةٍ يَحْسَبُهُ الظَّمْآنُ مَاءً حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَهُ لَمْ يَجِدْهُ شَيْئًا وَوَجَدَ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ فَوَفَّاهُ حِسَابًا. The Quran says that the good deeds of an unbeliever would be like a mirage. Somebody in the desert looking at a mirage will consider it to be a water pool. When he rushes to reach it, he will find nothing. And that's how the unbeliever can get his reward in this world. But once he faces his creator on the day of judgment, he will find nothing at all. But what about the bad deeds of an unbeliever? The Quran tells us that bad deeds of an unbeliever are like an accumulation of layers of darkness, one above the other. And it gives the example of the darkness at the bottom of a vast sea or ocean. A very deep sea and ocean is actually immersed into absolute darkness. And that's what the bad deeds of an unbeliever will look like on the day of judgment. The Quran reads, أو كظلمات في بحر لجي. You see, these are the bad deeds of an unbeliever. أو كظلمات في بحر لجي. يغشاه موج من فوقه موج من فوقه سحاب. ظلمات بعضها فوق بعض. إذا أخرج يده لم يكد يراها. ومن لم يجعل الله له نورا فما له من نور. This verse actually needs a whole episode to explain. And I will read the English translation as much as I can. Or is the like of the depths of darkness in a vast deep ocean. Or is the like of the darkness at the depths of a vast deep ocean. These are the bad deeds of an unbeliever. Overwhelmed with waves. Overwhelmed with waves. Topped by other waves. Topped by clouds. A multitude of darkness, one above the other, a multitude of darkness, one above the other. Whoever will stretch out his hand he can hardly see it. Whoever would stretch out his hand, he can hardly see it. For whoever Allah did not give light, means guidance here, there can never be any light guidance for him. There can never be any guidance for him, the light or guidance for him. And it's really amazing for the Quran to spell one of the greatest scientific discoveries of our time. To translate, the Quran describes the bad deeds of an unbeliever in this way. Or is the like of the depths a vast deep ocean? Because nowadays we know that the bottoms of the vast deep oceans are submerged in absolute darkness. And he explains, and the Quran explains, why this darkness. He says, because this darkness will be topped by waves, topped by other waves, topped by clouds, and in this absolute darkness, one layer above the other, if somebody stretches out his hand, he can never see it. And it ends by saying, whoever would never receive the light or the guidance from Allah can never be guided. The glorious Quran is describing the bad deeds of unbelievers and their fate in the life to come on the Day of Judgment as somebody submerged in absolute darkness. And the verse reads, أو كظلمات في بحر لجي يغشاه موج من فوقه موج من فوقه سحاب ظلمات بعضها فوق بعض إذا أخرج يده لم يكد يراها ومن لم يجعل الله له نورا فما له من نور. So to translate this, the Quran says, the like of the great darkness at the bottom of a vast deep ocean. And this bottom is covered by waves, topped by other waves, topped by clouds. And it reads three different layers of darkness, one above the other. And it adds, whoever does not receive the proper divine guidance can never be guided. Whoever does not receive the light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the word light here means guidance, can never see any light or receive any guidance. And it's really amazing for the Quran, a book revealed more than 14 centuries ago to an unlettered prophet, peace be upon him, in an unlettered society, to spell out a scientific fact disclosed to man only in the latest decades of the 20th century. Towards the middle part of the 20th century, we came to realize that there are inner waves within the water body. Nobody believed that before the middle part of the 20th century. All scientists, all oceanographers believed that we have only surface currents, surface waves, and they divide them into wind-driven currents and tidal currents. Until 1950, nobody could believe that there is a possibility of having a current within the water body. Only after the middle part of the 20th century, oceanographers started to realize that there are what they call oceanic currents. And these oceanic currents are within the water body. So when we see light coming from the sun, we will find that 49% of the sun rays are reflected by clouds. So this is the first level of darkness imposed on the earth. The 51% of the light of the sun rays, once they come to the surface of water, most of it will be utilized in evaporating the water to enhance the water cycle. And only 10% of the sun rays can penetrate the water body. Once this 10% of the sun rays penetrate the water body, it started to be analyzed into different wavelengths. And the first wavelength that would be absorbed by water is the red wavelength. So much so that if a diver would get hurt at a level more than 10 meters, he can never see the blood because all the red waves have been absorbed by water. This is followed by the orange wavelength, the yellow wavelength, the green wavelength, and the blue wavelength. which is the longest, and that's why we see the water mass in seas and oceans with the blue color, and we see the sky with a blue color as well. And once these waves reach the oceanic currents, nothing of it can penetrate. So the greatest depths of seas and oceans are submerged in absolute darkness. The red wavelength is absorbed at 10 meters. At 100 meters, only 0.1% of the sun rays can penetrate, also being analyzed in its different wavelengths. After 200 meters, only 0.1% can penetrate. Once we reach the oceanic currents, nothing can penetrate at all. And if we know that the average depth of oceans is in the range of 4 kilometers, and the sum of the depths of oceans can exceed 11 kilometers, like the Mariana Deeps in the Pacific Ocean, we can imagine that the greatest part of the deep oceans are actually submerged in absolute darkness. We will have a short break and we'll come back to comment on this absolute darkness at the bottoms of seas and oceans, which the Quran tries to simulate the bad deeds of unbelievers on the Day of Judgment with it. So wait for us and we'll come back to you soon. Welcome back, dear viewers. We were talking about the similarity of the bad deeds of unbelievers on the Day of Judgment. And we mentioned that the good deeds of any unbeliever will be rewarded in this world, and he will never find anything on the Day of Judgment out of what he did good in this world. But the bad deeds are simulated in the Quran by a multitude of darkness, a layer of darkness above a layer of darkness above a layer of darkness. And it's giving the similarity of the great darknesses at the depths of great seas and oceans. And we came to realize only very recently that 49% of the sun rays are reflected by the clouds, and only 51% of the sun rays can reach the upper surface of seas and oceans. Most of these rays are consumed in evaporating oceanic waters so that to enhance the water cycle around the Earth, or the hydrogeological cycle. Only 10% of the sun rays can penetrate the water body. The sun rays get absorbed wavelength after wavelength, so much so that nothing can penetrate after 100 meters, more than probably 0.1% of the sun rays. Then after 200 meters, 0.01%. And this goes on being gradually minimized until it faces the oceanic currents, which are below the surface currents. Of course, the surface currents play a very important role in creating a degree of darkness. So we have the surface currents, wind-driven currents and tidal currents, minimizing the amount of sun rays penetrating the water body. And then the sun rays gets analyzed in its different wavelengths that would be absorbed by the water body gradually. When this reaches the oceanic current, nothing of the sun rays can penetrate. So this is usually at a depth of no more than 1 kilometer. And if we understand that the average depth of an ocean is 4 kilometers, we can immediately realize that the greatest depths of oceans and deep seas are actually submerged in absolute darkness. Not a single sun ray can reach it. And if we understand that in the Pacific Ocean, we have deeps that exceed 11 kilometers in depth, we can imagine the absolute darkness under which the ocean bottoms are submerged with. So for the Quran to spell that out in a parallel, in a simulation, trying to represent that ill-doers, unbelievers, who will do the wrong in this world, And most of them do that, will find their deeds absolute darkness, layers of darkness one above the other, so that they can be found in absolute darkness. They can never receive any light. And for the Quran, really a book revealed more than 14 centuries ago, to spell out this scientific fact that the sun rays sheltered by the clouds can, or the clouds can create a certain level of darkness on the surface of the earth, and then the surface currents of the oceans and seas can create the second darkness, and the oceanic currents can create the third darkness, so that the bottoms of oceans and deep seas can be submerged in absolute darkness, and it simulates the future of the bad deeds of unbelievers on the day of judgment with this absolute darkness is something that's absolutely amazing. Nobody on earth could have dreamt of knowing this fact before the middle of the 20th century. For the Quran to spell that out in a simulation, in giving the parallel, in giving an example, is something absolutely amazing, and testifies to the fact that the Quran cannot be the work of man. It's the word of the Creator in its divine purity. It has been preserved in its language of revelation, word to word and letter to letter. Not a single letter has been removed from the glorious Quran. Not a single word has been changed over the past 14 centuries or so. Not only this, but the verse terminates by saying, whoever would never receive the guidance from Allah can never be guided. Whoever would never receive the light from Allah can never have a light. And this is a metaphoric expression, is saying that anybody living on the surface of that planet without receiving the divine guidance, he or she can never be guided. Because we know that man needs revealed knowledge in as much as he needs the acquired knowledge. The revealed knowledge comes down in areas that cannot be clearly addressed by man, such as the area of faith, the area of the moral code, the area of acts of worship, the area of the code of transactions with others. These four basic areas cannot be correctly addressed by man, and hence the need for religion. And in as much as man cannot live peacefully and happily and successfully on the surface of that planet without religion, religion cannot be man-made. And if we accept that this argument, we can have a clear-cut criterion by which we can discriminate between a true religion and a false one. And this criterion is the authenticity of the revelation that was sent down with the religion. And if we can apply this criterion to all the isms of the time, we can see clearly that the only form of divine revelation that has been kept intact in exactly the same language of revelation, the Arabic language, preserved by the will of Allah, word to word and letter to letter, is the glorious Quran. And here I would like to emphasize the fact that this simulation has got an example at the bottoms of seas and oceans. Oceanographers and ocean scientists have always claimed that life is impossible at the greatest depths of seas and oceans because of the absolute darkness, because of the water pressure. 4 kilometers of a column of water is too much for any living being to withstand, because of the gradual cooling of this water mass towards the bottoms of seas and oceans. But only very recently, oceanographers have developed certain submarines by which they went down to the bottoms of seas and oceans. And for their surprise, they found a flourishing life that's much greater in size than life in the upper 100 meters of the seas and oceans. And they wondered how these life forms can exist in this absolute darkness. And they came to realize that the Creator, all glory be to him, has given each animal living in that darkness a personal source of light, a certain chemical compound, and a certain hormone. Once this animal can add the hormone to that chemical compound, or that chemical compound to the hormone, it lights his way. So the verse says, whoever would never get the guidance from Allah can never be guided. Whoever would never get the light from Allah can never see the light. And this comes in a metaphoric way, yet it becomes absolutely correct. And we have recently discovered that all animals and plants living at the great depths of seas and oceans have got a personal source of light, which was given to them by the Creator, all glory be to Him. So every scientific notion in the glorious Quran, whether it comes as a direct notion or comes in the context of testifying to the might, knowledge, and wisdom of the Creator, or in the context of testifying to the fact that who has created is capable of annihilating his creation and resurrecting everything again, or even comes in the context of a metaphor or in giving an example, it remains absolutely scientifically correct because it is the word of the Creator in its divine purity. And as we repeatedly mentioned here, that explaining these scientific notions in the Quran and the Sunnah, using the facts discovered in the era of science and technology of our time, is a way that can help Muslims to understand these cosmic verses in a better way. And at the same time, once we understand the scientific notion in that phrase, in this ayah, we can prove the precedence of the Quran with many, many scientific facts that were only disclosed to man in the 20th century or even later. And this precedence of the Quran with a large quantity of scientific notions is a living testimony that the Quran cannot be the work of man. It's the divine word in its divine purity. And this can be used as a source of da'wah, inviting people to Islam in the era of science and technology we are living in an era whenever you discuss something with anybody, he will ask for the scientific proof. And these scientific notions in Quran and Sunnah are the scientific proofs of the authenticity of the Quran, the divine nature of the Quran, and the correct prophethood of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. With this, I come to the end of this episode, hoping to meet again in another episode on the same topic. And until that time, I leave you in peace and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace and blessings be with you all.